Good morning students, welcome to you all 12th standard commerce. In this video we are going to discuss unit 10 company law or secretarial practice chapter 26 companies act 2013 introduction of companies act 2013 and second topic evaluation and history of company law in India.
So chapter 26 companies act 2013. So when we discuss the Companies Act before that, always the Companies Act is 1956. But now the Companies Act 1956 is modified to Companies Act 2013. So the concept of company or corporation in business is not new, but was dealt in the 4th century itself during the Arthashastra days. Okay, so in the word dealt with the Arthashastra days, it is not a new word to in our history. So it is formed like a company. So it shaped a god revamp over a period of time according to the needs of business dynamics. Company form of business has certain distinct advantages over other form of business like sole proprietorship, partnership, etc. So it includes features such as limited liability, perpetual succession, etc. So why it is formed like a company name of company name? The company form of business is better than any other form of business like sole proprietorship, partnership, etc. So if compare the sole proprietorship and partnership of the company form of organization is better. Because the reason, if you run the sole proprietorship, anything happen into the anything happen the proprietor, they affect the business also. The business comes to an end. Okay, so that's why the company form of organization is better. So the special features is given company form of organization: limited liability and perpetual succession. So the special two features company form of organization is better. Next topic, evaluation and history of company law in India. The earliest business association in England were the Merchant Guilds. Some of the merchant association or guilds who have the regulated the companies. So first, a royal charter established in the East Indian Company in the year 1600. So first charter Royal Charter is established the East Indian Company in the year 1600. Then second, in England, the Joint Stock Companies Act was passed for the first time in 1844. So first of all, in England, the Joint Stock Company Act passed in the year 1844. Next, in the year 1850, taking the English Joint Stock Companies Act 1844 as a base, a provision was made for registration of joint stock companies in India. So in the year 1850, that means in the year 1844, formed the Joint Stock Companies Act in England. In 1850, it has been in the year 1844 taken as a base. They formed the Joint Stock Company, framed a new act in India 1850. The next one, the Joint Stock Companies Act was passed in the India by introducing the concept of limited liability in the year 1857. That means the act is introduced, new act is introduced in 1857 by showing the special feature is limited liability. So the limited liabilities attract the many investors come forward and invest the money to the company form of organization. Okay. Next, in 1930, the Indian Companies Act of 1913 was passed. So the act introduced the institution of private companies in the corporate sector in India. So after independence, based on the recommendation of the Srihashi Baba Committee in 1950 and the provision of English Companies Act 1948, the Companies Act 1956 was introduced in the Parliament. That means against one more act was passed. 1930, so the year in 1913, they introduced the private private companies into come forward into the corporate sector in India. So after the independence, based on the recommendation of Sri H.C. Baba Committee in 1950, they called the 1950 and the provision of English Companies Act 1948. That means based on the recommend of H.C. Baba 1948, English Companies Act and 1950 H.C. Baba Committees Act, both together they formed a new act 1956, introduced a 1956 act in the parliament. So they called the private into the corporate sector. So the Companies Act 1956 came into the force of 1st April 1956. The main objectives of company law 1956 are: first point, to sustain trust and faith of shareholders. Second, to protect and preserve the rights of shareholders. To protect the shareholders and preserving the shareholders. Then third, because of shareholders is the owner of the company. So that's why we have to protect and preserve the rights of shareholders. Then third one, to have a drastic control over all the activities of the company. So to increase the control of business activities of the company. Then to make the regulation of an effective annual meeting, to have a different meeting, you know, that shareholders meeting, board of directors meeting, general meeting. So to make the regulation of effective annual meeting. The next one, the investment of general public should be used for the development of society or social welfare activities. So the amount or invested investment general public means the amount invested by the public in the joint stock company, so that should be utilized for the society or social welfare activities for development. So these are the main objectives of in Companies Act 1956. Next, the Companies Act 1956 has been amended from time to time. So from 2006 to 2009, some important changes was made. So 1956, after that, 2006 to 2009, some changes in the Companies Act. So first one, the Company Law Board has been abolished and a National Company Law Tribunal is formed. Okay, so instead of Company Law Board, the National Company Law Tribunal is formed. Then second one, the rehabilitation of Sikh companies will be undertaken by the NCLT and not by the Board of Industrial and Financial Reconstruction. So that means what is the role of NCLT? So rehabilitation of Sikh companies. Okay, so improvement of Sikh companies under the control is NCLT. So before the rehabilitation is done by only the BIFR, Board of Industrial Financial Reconstruction. The next one, earlier the BIFR was entrusted with the rehabilitation of Sikh companies as the matter came under the jurisdiction of the Sikh Industrial Companies Act in 1985, SICA. But now the Sikh Industrial Companies Repeal Act 2003 has replaced SICA and the work of revival and rehabilitation has been entrusted to NCLT. That means in 1985 there was an act that is only look for the Sikh companies. That act is called a Sikh Industrial Companies Act. It is passed in the year 1985. So again, the Companies Act has been amended in the year 2013 and has introduced several new concepts and definitions. So next we are going to see Companies Act 2013. The new 2000 Companies Act got a assent of present on 29th August 2013, but it was passed in the Lok Sabha on 18th December 2012 and in Rajya Sabha on 8th August 2013. So that 2013 consists of 29 chapters, 470 sections and 7 schedules as against 13 chapters, 658 sections and 15 schedules in 1956 Act. So separate the chapters from register, valuers, government, companies, furnish information of statistics, NITIS, National Company Law Tribunal and Appellate Tribunal and Special Courts are introduced in the Companies Act 2013.
I hope you all understood this topic, evaluation and history of law in India. Thank you.